read the Post, but I don't buy it.
Good evening. My name is Archie Bishop. Tonight, we are going to be looking at one of New York's premier institutions, the New York Post. But first, let's have a look at this. Each day, the headlines of the New York Post call out to us. They scream at us, demanding our attention. What you have just seen was an arranged sequence of Post headlines. But in the arrangement, something has been revealed. What we have seen is the Post's ability to tell a story. It is a story which touches our deepest fears. It is a story which carries us to the brink of disaster, then carries us back to safety. Tomorrow, another disaster will be there. We will be rescued once again. But more than tell a story, the Post helps to shape the way in which we understand reality itself.
Did you personally experience the unsafety in real life, or you find that the newspaper give you more idea about how
what's safe? Going on? Uh-huh. Yeah. Yes, I think it's better to read the papers because you don't get all the angles in your own life, you know, but it happens in others who can be quite near you, quite close to you, and still not hear of it. If you don't come in contact with your neighbors constantly, as I don't always.
Tonight, we will be looking at the New York Post a little more closely. We'll be looking at its style of journalism, and we will be trying to understand what makes this bizarre newspaper tick. Huge newspaper market, there are two distinctly different approaches to journalism. The first is best exemplified by the New York Times. This is a very serious paper. It is filled with words, words that claim to be facts. It is an appeal to reason. Its basic claim is that it is thorough and that it is reliable. We must work hard to read this paper. At the end of a day, if we've read the Times, we feel like we have achieved something. We are proud of ourselves. It gives us status in the world. It is a sign of affluence or of upward mobility. In New York City, to read the Times is to have good credentials.
I usually read the New York Times.
Why?
Well, I think it's the best newspaper. It's on a level that I like. It's usually honest. It's not. It's on a level that I enjoy. I think the other ones are on a much lower level, and I don't enjoy reading them as much.
If I want to just relax and read something light and entertaining, I would read the Post or the Daily News. If I want to read something that I think is a little more serious view of things and more realistic, I'd read the New York Times. So
I like the Post. It's a poor people newspaper. The Times isn't.
Do you read the New York Times?
No, I don't. Too expensive.
I read the news. My son is a lawyer. He reads the Times. So therefore, you know what I mean?
That's the story,
that's
huh?
That's story. The story. The smarter people read the Times.
Don't say the smarter,
no, the smarter people.
Read the Times. I dare you say the smarter.
The smarter people read the Times.
You look at her. Would you believe this? Yes.
You ever read the New York Times?
I think that's a little too big a paper for me. Yeah. No.
Most New Yorkers prefer another kind of journalism. It is called sensationalistic. And the best example of sensationalism is the New York Post. If the Times appeals to reason, the Post appeals to the irrational. If the details that we see in the Times are facts to be remembered, to be quoted, the details in the Post reach into our innermost fears, our innermost desires.
It's more informative, and they tell you to detail of what happens.
Well, I like it because I think they tell the truth about everything. They bring out all the details about everything, and I believe it. What they write is true.
That's what the New York Post is primarily dealing with, very gory details.
What kind of stuff do you read in the Post?
I like sex stuff, you know.
No. In New York City, people live in different ways. Many spend their lives struggling for a better way of life. Some live on Easy Street. In some communities, people work with each other. Some people work mainly for themselves. Daily life in New York can be hard. It can be confusing. Each day, the Post headlines parade before our eyes, and they add to the confusion. But we are drawn to them like a magnet.
Whenever I get up by the Triborough Bridge, all them boys selling the Post, I buy it.
I like the headlines. They always attract my attention, and so I naturally have to delve into them and find out what it's all about.
They always have big headlines.
Yeah.
Yep, that's a good paper.
They always print the bad news so big, you know, they don't ever print no good news. Big letters, granny dies, you know, they should put some news, something nice, you know. Then let us read the inside of something. You don't want to buy a paper we're talking bad news.
Uh-huh.
Yeah?
So they always put bad news, so you never think, so what's your image, like if a New York paper always putting bad news about New York, so what do you think about New York? Did you think the newspaper give you a feeling like the New York is a big...
Doesn't. I wouldn't want to come here if I was from someplace else, and I was to meet people, I wouldn't want to come over here to the city. You'd be scared to come to the city and read stuff like this every day. No?
Yeah.
Gives anybody a bad feeling. No, it gives me a bad feeling. I was born here. You know, and I feel bad. All the time I look at the paper, I read the same thing all the time. Most of the while you see this, Heroes of New York. Most of the while. But that's what I got to say about the paper. I don't read the paper too much. I always got too much bad news anyway.
If the Post presents us with a picture of the world, we must ask, what is in that picture?
Downfall picks up locomotion.
In the post, we get a glimpse of New York, but we do not see the city through our own lives and through our own experiences. The post instead tells a story. It is a story of random violence and random luck. In the pages of the post, the world is beyond comprehension. All meaning has broken down. Everyday people are caught in the middle of a cosmic crapshoot. If they win, they become millionaires or heroes. If they lose, their greatest fears will come true. Daily life itself becomes a nightmare. According to the Post, even when we win, we may lose. In the New York Post, we see a world which is ruled by chaos. There are no explanations, only confusions. The Post doesn't educate us to understand our world better. It educates us to understand things less and less. It makes us feel helpless and fearful. Our only hope is to win the lottery or the police. Behind this crazy world of the New York Post, there is a call for law and order, for discipline, for more repression. This message is reinforced daily by the way in which the New York Post tells its story. At the center of the New York Post's world stands the police station. The police blotter becomes a lens through which we view the city, and crime stands at the center of the drama. But not all crime. The abuse of power is rarely a part of the New York Post stories. Only the most sensational crimes are chosen. This is what sells papers. This is what makes a good and juicy story.
Well, a lot has to do with the layout, the headlines. You know, they use a lot of red in their layout, and that's always an attraction. And there's always something to do with violence on the cover, usually, and people love to read about that.
Yeah.
And it's an attention grabber.
Yeah, what do you think the reason for the Post headlines are? people's ongoing fascination with all things grotesque.
On the pages of the New York Post, the chaos is transformed into a story. Reality becomes a cops and robbers tale. Cops are the heroes of the New York Post drama, sometimes firemen. Occasionally, an ordinary person can become a hero, but only when they act like a cop or a fireman. People who do grassroots work to help and work with their communities are not the heroes of the Post. The idea that people take control of their own lives is not a part of the New York Post story. Today's Post is like every other day's Post.
You have to wonder, because, you know, each front page is different, although it might be the same story.
The message of the Post is repeated again and again. The faces may change, but that bad taste stays in your mouth. Beyond being a story of cops and robbers, the Post can be understood as a kind of formula. There are three parts to this formula: fantasy, morality, and authority. Let's look at each piece within the New York Post formula for news. The first part is fantasy. The Post appeals to our deepest fears and desires. On its pages, our fantasies come true. If not for us, then for people like us. Some of these fantasies are good. People are catapulted from poverty to riches on the pages of the New York Post. On page 6 each day, we can follow the lives of celebrities, of the rich and famous, and if we can't live like them, at least we can look into their intimate lives. We can know more about them than we do about our neighbors. Through the Post, we become a part of their world, if only in newsprint. When one of them dies, it becomes our loss. We enter a world of fairy tale princesses in the New York Post. But fantasy is a mixed bag. If the Post allows us to dream, it also fulfills our worst nightmares. Every space of the city is filled with demons. Supernatural forces roam our streets. Within such a world, we feel helpless, like we may fall at any time into some deep abyss. While the Post engages our fantasies, it also tells us that to dream is dangerous. The very mysterious forces which may bring us millions may leave us victims of an axe murderer. The next part of the formula is morality. In the midst of this chaotic world, the Post presents itself as a moral force, a judge. If something is wrong in this crazy world, the Post will be there to call it wrong. But more than this, the Post transforms the world into a moral lesson. This was the cover of the New York Post on the day that Carmine Galante was shot while eating in a restaurant in Brooklyn. Galante was the capo di tutti capi, the head of the New York Mafia. Now, first of all, this is a very big story. We know this because the front page wraps all the way around to the back page, the sports page. In the New York Post, murder is a kind of sport. At the bottom, we see a wide picture of Galante, the godfather, sprawled on the ground. If you look closely, you will see that he still has a cigar clenched in his teeth. He's the godfather to the end. The caption to the picture points this out. Now, all of this is important because beyond telling us that this man was murdered, the Post is drawing a whole bunch of conclusions. It is appealing to certain cultural stereotypes that are repeated again and again in America by the Post, in the movies, on TV. We are being encouraged to see Carmine Galante in a certain kind of way. Above the picture, sprawled across the cover, front and back, is one word: greed. Now, this is not news. It is a moral lesson. We are being told that greed is the cause of Galante's fall, that greed is punished. Once again, the forces of the supernatural have come into play. What is interesting is that such lessons, such messages of moral justice, can be used selectively. In other cases, even where they might be appropriate, such morality tales are not told. When Rockefeller died in the arms of his illicit playmate, the Post did not say greed. When the telephone company doubles the phone rates, the Post does not say greed. When the Post doesn't want to point its oily finger at corruption, it doesn't. The Post presents itself as a force of morality, but only sometimes. The Post never points the moral finger at itself. It never asks what it means for a paper to bring fear and terror into the lives of a million people every day. The Post, like Caesar's wife, is beyond suspicion, in the pages of the New York Post, at least. Within the Post's vision of the world, the Post is one of New York's heroes, like the cops and the firemen. After fantasy and morality, the last piece, the solution within the Post formula, is authority. That's what it all adds up to. The Post is an ongoing call for authoritarianism. It endorses law and order candidates. In its editorials, it calls for harsh disciplines. Even its fun pages are filled with the advice of authorities. After reading the New York Post, this authoritarianism makes sense. We are presented with a world in which people are helpless, continually bombarded by forces greater than themselves. We are presented a world gone mad, a world of chaos and lunacy. All order has broken down. Children kill old people. Incest is everywhere. Kidnapping. Wolf packs roam the streets. Enemies surround us. In such a world, even with a wonderful paper like the New York Post offering us prize money, every day our chances of surviving, in one piece at least, are slim indeed. What is to be done? There is no relief in sight. On Christmas, lovers murder each other. On Valentine's Day, lovers are slain in Lover's Lane. Even our moments of pleasure are filled with blood. What is to be done? From reading the New York Post, there is only one answer, and that answer is martial law. In a world of fantasy and danger, we are constantly reminded what the moral outcome should be. For the Post, the only way to achieve that outcome is to become more and more authoritarian. Ultimately, the world as depicted by the Post becomes a justification for authority, for moral law, for vigilantism, a justification for the power and authority of the New York Post itself. How does the Post keep us within its grip? What must we do to break out of that grip? News events are continually headlined with the titles of movies. We are continually encouraged to use the media, in this case movies, as our basic point of reference, to understand life itself as a media event, a Hollywood spectacle. This creates entertainment value. This tells us that what is important is what is in the media. This keeps us from asking questions, This keeps us from looking towards ourselves for alternatives. For example, by labeling an office tower fire Towering Inferno, we immediately think of the movie. How can the fire safety violations in our houses compare with this one? By labeling a sex murderer Phantom of the Opera, sociopathic behavior is given a romantic flair. The ways our society encourages sexual violence is lost in such a telling of the story. Overall, such headlines put the media at the center of what is happening. The event is shaped to conform to the media world. This justifies the authority of newspapers like the New York Post. The Post puts itself continually at the center of its universe. The Post itself is the big story. Wherever things are important, the Post will be there. It takes us to the brink of the event, not just the facts, but the feeling of the event, or so it claims. By always turning our eyes back in the direction of the media, the Post does its best to ensure that we don't look towards ourselves to deal with the problems, the realities around us, to find solutions. To change this, we must look more towards ourselves. We must begin to look at the way a paper like the Post stands between us and a better world, between us and meaningful social change. We must make sure that we don't end up like these people. The time has come for people to make headlines of our own. This is Archie Bishop signing off.
The message of this evening's program has been that we must break through the surface of the media. In keeping with that message, the part of Archie Bishop has been played by Stuart Ewen.